következő műsorszám 12 éven aluliak számára nem ajánlott. In other words, if you are 12 years old or younger, you should be in school and not listening to this radio show.
You're not dumb enough to actually try it. Know your rights. These are your rights. Oh, know your rights. These are your rights.
Welcome to the March 25th, 2013 edition of Mindenki Yoga. This is JD.
Interrupting all programs.
This is a radio crash on pirate satellite. Orbiting your living room, cashing in the Bill of Rights. Cuban army surplus or refusing of the lights. This is radio crash on pirate satellite. Yeah!
On this edition of Mindenki Yoga, we have a lot to talk about. We have a great conversation with József Böröcz, who's a Hungarian-American now, a sociologist in Rutgers University in New Jersey, United States. And with that, we're going to be talking with Vincent Liegey, which we've had on the show before, and Zoltan Lakatos, which we've also had on the show. And with a cameo appearance by TGM, Gáspár Miklós Tamás, who just so happened to enter the conversation randomly. We'll talk more about that later. And then at the end, I'll play a clip from Paul Murphy, MEP, European Parliament member from the Republic of Ireland. And the theme of the show is going to be about financial capitalism and liberal democracy and the prospects of somehow getting out of this first world recession, depression that we're in, and whether or not we can get out of it and still hold on to any concept of democracy in the end. So last Friday, we had a group conversation with József Böröcz at the Espresso Embassy, which is on Arany János utca in the 5th District of Budapest. And József Böröcz, he's a sociologist from Rutgers University, which is in New Jersey, United States. He's a critical sociologist with a historical and comparative sociology. Studies global structures and social change, state socialism and its legacy, which is, I think, very, very good topic for Hungary. He left Hungary in the 80s, but he's been back and forth a lot since then. And he's back in Budapest just for a few more days, so it was really great to have a conversation with him. And in with the conversation is Vincent Liegey, which I've had on the show before. He's a leader of the degrowth movement. He's an environmentalist. He's from France. But what I like about his degrowth movement, it's not just an environmental movement that talks about the trees and talks about saving the environment, but also talks about human rights and democratic rights, and which is one problem I often have with environmentalists is that they seem very uninterested at times about humans. But maybe that's unfair to say that. But Vincent Liegey is talking about how to transform our societies into something democratic and ecologically sustainable at the same time. And then also we have Zoltan Lakatos, who's at ELTA Faculty of Social Sciences, Institute of Sociology. And we've had him on the show in the past as well, just recently with a conversation about Mali and the French intervention into Mali. And then, strangely, in the middle of the show, TGM, Hungary's most well-known left Marxist philosopher, suddenly appears, and you'll hear that part. And he just got back from from the other cafe in the 6th District, Shirai, which is a very well-known cafe that's currently been shut down. Long, complicated story there, but has been shut down by the local government for whatever reasons. I really can't figure it out. But anyways, there's a student occupation of this cafe. It's a very... actually, I've done many interviews in the cafe in the past before they shut it down, unfortunately. And it's a very nice Jewish cafe in the 6th District. And I will miss it. I hope they reopen it someday. But anyways... Gáspár comes in and says that the students take it over. So that's so it was very nice to have him contribute to the show. And then at the end of this, after this very intense discussion, I'm going to play a clip from Paul Murphy, who's an MEP, a representative of the Republic of Ireland in the European Parliament. I've also had him on the show, and you might remember him because he was on one of the flotillas. A bunch of boats that tried to get to Gaza, Palestine, trying to break the Israeli embargo. But he will be speaking, he's going to be speaking at this clip is where he's speaking in the European Parliament, they call it the DAL, European Parliament the Joint Subcommittee on European Union Affairs. And the topic is Ireland and the Future of the European Union. Now, this fits into everything that we're talking about with József Böröcz, because Paul Murphy is talking about can democracy really exist? And we're not talking about utopian democracy, we're just talking about normal liberal democracy. Can it really exist on the national level anymore when you have the IMF and the ECB, which is the European version of that, dictating the terms of bailouts to countries, to the pigs, the P-I-I-G-S, the Portugal, Ireland, Italy, Greece, and Spain, and more recently, Cyprus, which is now needing a bailout, which all these countries wedded themselves to this financial capitalism, thinking it was all going to work out in the long run, but ended up racking up huge amounts of debt. And ended up, these national governments ended up being responsible for bailing out banks. And since the national governments cannot pay off these banks that have had so many problems, therefore, they have to go to the ECB and the IMF. Anyways, I'm not an economist, but anyways, it means the short version of it is that national governments and parliaments really don't have any say anymore or have any control over their economies. So how is that democratic? There might be elections, but is there democracy? This is the larger theme that we talked about with József Böröcz, as well as talking about Hungary, specifically within the European Union, but also within the world overall, and this neoliberal ideology and how it just kind of, the mainstream right is completely neoliberal and the mainstream left of Hungary is completely neoliberal. And how did Hungary switch from this Soviet-style socialism to this Reagan-Thatcherite neoliberalism so quickly from the 90s until today. Anyway, so that is a whole big mouthful of different ideas, and we're going to talk about all those things starting right now with a discussion with József Böröcz. So, thank you all for coming on the Mindenki Yoga radio show on Civil Radio 98 FM. We're here to have a discussion with József Böröcz and with Zoltan Lakatos and Vincent Liegey.
Yeah, great.
Thank you. And József did a lecture recently at Corvinus University, and so I want him to tell us a little bit about what he was talking about, the themes of that. But the others here, I want to have them respond to that as well as talk about other things. So first. József Böröcz, could you please just introduce yourself?
My name is József Böröcz. I'm from Budapest, and for almost 30 years I've been mainly living in the United States. Currently I'm professor of sociology at Rutgers University. And of course you're asking completely impossible that, I should represent a one-hour lecture which included 46 extremely important visual aids on the radio in 1 minute. So I guess, look, the to cut through a lot of the chase, there is this new institution around in the world called the European Union. There is a complete absence or almost complete absence of a conversation about just what the EU is as a social institution, or to the extent that people address it, they kind of treat it as if it were a state, whereas everybody understands once they're pressed that it is not a state. A state is something that has an executive apparatus and it has accountability for the behavior of that executive apparatus. The EU has neither an executive apparatus of its own, nor is it accountable basically to anybody. So my lecture, whose title was something like the European Union as an object of critical historical geopolitical analysis. Maybe I just explain what I meant by those three terms, and then by critical, I meant I asked the audience, and pretty strongly I pressed this theme through the whole talk, to dissociate ourselves for a moment, or just to bracket for a second. This extremely powerful tradition, which by default automatically assumes that Europe means good, advanced, civilized, cultured, and all those things. In other words, there is an implicit understanding in global conversation, both political conversation that you get from the media, as well as scholarly conversation. That is things that scholars say in their writing and their lectures and so on, which operates on the assumption that there is Europe represented by the EU, that's already imprecise, of course, and then that's always on the top. And then all other forms of social practice are somehow inferior one way or another. So I asked people to sort of step back from that. In other words, I wasn't suggesting that there's anything inherently wrong. I'm just asking people to, for a moment, try to think about this institution as just one among the many, and what it is that we can say about that. Right? Now, the second point is historical. By historical, I mean you cannot understand the present from the present. It's never the case. And I'm a historical sociologist. My profession, the legitimacy of that particular field stems from the realization that to understand the present, you have to look in the past. What matters from the past is where that will determine outcomes in the present. The present is just a tiny, tiny part of what goes on, right? And there's a lot of unresolved issues that we sort of inherited from the past. And the third point, geopolitical analysis. By geopolitics, I meant an incredibly broad understanding of geopolitics, by which I basically meant the ways in which large institutions project their power to the world outside. And the main metaphor is, which I like very much to present to people, is that of the, let's say, a Greek vase. Most social science, I mean, I would say 98% of sociology or even political science, operates as if there was only an internal structure to what they observe. So, for instance, EU social science, writing about political science about the European Union, is only talking about Brussels, the relationship among the member states. Maybe sometimes they would mention the public, the European public, and they would perhaps mention capital. But all of these are internal to the EU. And almost nobody talks about the big question, which is the relationship of this institution to the rest of the world. And as a methodological presupposition to start with, you know, we sort of have to examine that. And so along these three themes, I basically asked people to sort of follow me on a tour, actually two little tours that I took. One was more of an economic, political economic conversation about Western Europe statehood and the history of the role of Europe in the world, Western Europe in the world, showing that you know, for a large part of human history, Western Europe was an incredibly insignificant, inconsequential part of the world, where meanwhile there were hugely important structures, for instance, the Afro-Eurasian trade system, which existed for 2,000 years, which basically pumped Chinese proto-industrial products as well as Indian agrarian products, particularly spices and so on, westward. and so on. And in this system, Europe was extremely incidental. The rise of Europe is a very recent phenomenon. And I showed a few graphs which indicated that, for instance, in 1820, China comprised 32% of the world economy. So when we talk about today, the rise of China and the big excitement is that, oh, I don't know, according to some estimations, maybe it's already reached 17-18% of the world economy, and in other words, just about the same level as Western Europe and the US. This is perceived as a crisis, but that's actually only about half of where China was only a little less than 200 years ago. That's almost nothing in historical terms. And so you know, this does put things in a different perspective. And in the very at the very end of my talk, I talked did a much shorter, a little smaller little circle, talking about moral geopolitics, understandings of self and other, particularly around the imagined concept of race, and the incredibly foundational role that West Europeans played in the construction of that falsehood. And a perpetuation of that violent representation of self and other, and that was it basically. Now I actually gave you however long it was outline. Well, maybe you guys should talk now because I basically took all my time for the whole afternoon.
That was great. Vincent, what do you think about that?
So maybe first I should introduce myself.
Please, yeah.
So my name is Vincent, I am Vincent Liegey, I am French, I live in Budapest, and I am dealing with the degrowth movement, which is a new political and academic international movement. And so degrowth, décroissance in French, and it's a provocative slogan saying something very, very simple to understand, that infinite growth in a finite world is something totally absurd. And we have an economic system and society, which institutionally, economically, politically, and culturally, which is totally depending on this growth and growth and growth. So we have to get out of this dependency and to think how to construct new models of society. So concerning my view about EU, I guess it's a bit it's a bit the topic. EU was constructed after the Second World War, mostly by French and German elites, to stop with that wars coming every second, third decades. And it was driven by peace views and to reconstruct Europe in another way. In the same time, we had a very important and very unique time of development, economic development, in Europe. We have to reconstruct the Europe after the Second World War, and we could also import a lot of resources, mostly for France, coming from our colonies in Africa and Asia. And we experience what we call these 30 glorious, I think you can say it, 30 holy or great years of development after the Second World War, with a huge development, huge economic growth. And during this time, there was no unemployment. Everybody could get a house. We welcome a lot of labor coming from our colonies, a lot of resources coming from Africa, etc. And we construct France and Western Europe in a very, very quick and nice way for 30 years. And we started to develop Europe as French and German people were not ready to collaborate with each other because of the war we just made. We started to use some economic tools. And step by step, what was first economic tools, because of this development time and also because of the political victory of neoliberalism, became the only things which made Europe. And we didn't have any political, cultural, or very, very short political and cultural construction of Europe. And now we are totally stuck in a crazy system with a common currency, with some institution, and no a common cultural and political culture or institution. Most of the European institutions have a huge lack of legitimacy. Just for example, in France we had a referendum in 2005 about a project of constitution for EU, which was rejected by the French people. It was also rejected by the Dutch people, but the elites said, okay, the people voted in the wrong way, so we're going to make the Lisbon treaty, which is more or less the same documents, and we go ahead in that way. Another example, because now we are in Hungary, the same text, this constitution, was voted by the Hungarian parliament 6 months before it was translated into Hungarian. So it means that the MPs voted for a text they didn't know. And it's just an example to see how fast and far we went into a very technocratic construction of European Union, only based on neoliberalism, only based on economic tools, only based around opening the market and a currency. And now we are facing a crisis, which is a very strong, deep economic crisis, which is, I think, even more, it's a crisis of civilization. And we have a type of institution without any legitimacy, without any... among the elites, they don't understand at all what we're facing, and they go closer, and they go deeper and deeper and deeper to this blindness to protect a strong euro, to protect independency of the European Central Bank, and in the same time to push all the states to apply crazy austerity plans like what we can see in Greece, but also here in Hungary, which have very devastating consequences, human consequences, on the everyday life of the people, economic and also really human. It's a disaster what's happening with that austerity plans. And step by step, we can see the rise of nationalism back. And what was the main goal first of Europe? To have peace, to have a European identity, to live together, to have open borders, to make the people meet with each other, to learn foreign languages and share cultures, etc., is about to collapse. Because what was first the tool we used to construct that became like a dogma. We speak about the religion of economics, and we are only trying to save this dogma, this crazy religion of economics, this strong euro, and we are about to destroy what was the main goal first. And we can see, like in the 30s, we can see a lot of phenomenon which are really, really frightening. For example, today there will be a football game in Hungary between Romania and Hungary. There will be another one between Serbia and Croatia. And there are very, very, very strong tension between these countries. And Europe, they don't understand that at all. In Brussels, they only speak about money. Only money, they only speak about growth, they only speak about a strong euro, they only speak about the debt crisis, they only speak about austerity plans and measures to control the debt. And we destroy everything which still make our societies civilized. We destroy education, we destroy health, we destroy solidarity, we destroy public services, etc.
Zoltan, Lakatos, try to top that.
Should I introduce myself?
Yeah.
My name is Zoltan Lakatos. I'm a sociologist. I lecture at the Budapest University, BME. And one of my research area is the research into what's called social values, and especially the interconnections between economic growth and social values. And one of the interesting conclusions I arrived at doing my research is that there is none. There's no connection whatsoever between social social values or culture, to put it more briefly, and the economic growth. And the way it's, I mean, the connections with the ideas of Vincent and Joseph is that it's interesting to see that recently there are a lot of attempts inside academia to construct ideologies that have the appearance of being scientific, but at the same time serve elite interests. So just taking the example of my own field, social science, there are a lot of efforts to identify some type of core European set of values that might explain the technological advance, the more advanced technological development of European countries or North America. And when judged on an empirical basis, I mean all these efforts fail. I mean, just to give you the most the best known example is Samuel Huntington's thesis on the clash of civilizations, which is totally false. You cannot validate it on an empirical basis. There's no evidence. It's totally rubbish. But it's interesting to see this opposition between Western social science and social science in countries of the former Soviet bloc. My country, Hungary included, especially. We have a visit by one of the most published, one of the most published and most cited Hungarian sociologists coming from the United States to Hungary, it's kind of weird that he doesn't get invited by official faculty members at the biggest Hungarian universities. Isn't it strange? Because, you know, the type of analysis József gave in the scope of his lecture is really embarrassing to elites in this country. And the problem is that most of social science in this part of the world is just serves elite interests, and it's not really empirically grounded. And even those social scientists who tend to agree with the analysis that, for example, József gave, try to avoid these discussions. Try to shun these topics altogether, because it's, you know, based on the friendships they have, based on the research programs they are involved in, based on the fundings they receive at their faculties, it's seen as a kind of nuisance. So my make a connection with my research interest is this new form of racism, which is more difficult to see at the surface, because it's not articulated in traditional racist. It's not articulated in traditional racist framework. By this I mean the biological or blood-related arguments. It's this new form of racism is articulated in cultural terms. And for this reason, it's it's less visible, but also more effective, because it belongs in the domain what Noam Chomsky calls the internalized assumptions. On my way here, I read an article in Népszabadság, which is perhaps the most important Hungarian daily newspaper, on the 10th commemorating, if I may say, the 10th anniversary of the Iraq War. And the internalized assumption was that, I mean, it wasn't put that way, but these nations are made up of savages, and we need to civilize them. And it was a well-intentioned effort on behalf of the Bush administration to liberate themselves from tyranny and so on and so on. But it was, the argument in favor of the Iraq war turned out to be false, because, you know, there were no weapons of mass destruction. But still, the effort is noble, and it's a pity that they didn't succeed in pacifying the country. And let's not forget that the introduction of democracy in the Middle East resulted in regimes hostile to Western interests in Tunisia, Egypt. So maybe democracy in the end is not a good thing for the Arab world, because, you know, they are culturally backward and so on and so on and so on. That's what I mean by internalized assumptions. And my field, which is social science, and especially in countries like Hungary, countries that should be thought of as client states in the post-Soviet framework, the U.S. client states, close to 100% of the relevant discussions on this topic in Hungarian academia and social sciences just recycle the same old journalistic bullshit, just in a more sophisticated way. So that's one of the reasons I found Joseph's lecture very interesting and thought-provoking. We should have more of this ideally inside official Hungarian academia.
Wow. Okay. So, lots of thoughts I have just briefly, and I'll let you all go at it again. But okay, to defend the European Union for a moment. I mean, yeah. Well, it's a hard job to do, but I will try. First of all, I mean, what I would say foreign policy for the EU is basically U.S.-led NATO. Doesn't really, and even if it's the new EU intervention into Mali, it still happens under the umbrella of drones by the U.S., so even if it's French-led. So I find that to me, that's the foreign policy. I don't know if that's the only foreign policy, but here we are in Hungary. I mean, if you look at, just for example, the LGBT gay rights issue all over Europe, this is progressing very fast in most countries. Even Hungary is not really going backwards on the issue in some respects, right? Even though it's negative in the constitution. But the issue of the rights of Roma Europeans would not even be discussed in Europe if it wasn't for the European Union. It certainly wouldn't even be on the radar in Hungary unless there was a Europe to kind of bother the Hungarian state about these issues. So isn't like the European Union a progressive force in that sense, or is it still illegitimate, as you say, Vincent, regardless, even if it's progressive?
You want to check?
Well, I mean, look, it's a big and very complex... The EU is a big and very complex organization, so it would be a superhuman effort not to have anything positive about it. You know, I mean, there are certain things that are obviously better than a completely divided continent with nation states that are, fighting each other on even more petty bullshit than what they're doing now, right? I mean, so of course, I mean, but that's pretty much goes without saying. I think Vince actually articulated that pretty well. Look, the thing about it, I mean, I on the one hand, I kind of agree with the claim that the foreign policy for the EU is to a large extent NATO, but keep in mind that it's a somewhat complicated issue because the relationship between the EU and NATO, first of all, it's an imperfect match because there are various parts of the EU are not NATO members, various parts of the NATO, importantly, are not members of the EU, although they're working on fixing that one as we speak with the North Atlantic Free Trade Agreement negotiations, which began a few months ago. But the point that I'm trying to make is that there are a number of things that are going on. First of all, the conventional military as well as nuclear defense of Western Europe is done by the United States. Okay, and so that's a certain dependency on part of Western Europe on the U.S. Everybody acknowledges that if you ask them or if you press them on that. It's fairly obvious. Now, because of that, in that regard, in that specific realm, the European Union does not have full sovereignty. Okay, it's a protectorate. Now, but it's a very, how shall I say, fancy, wealthy, and aesthetically very pleasing kind of protectorate, so far as that goes, you know? I mean, it's coffee is good and, life is, okay. But when we go beyond all that, there are a number of other issues which are not so nice. So there are two things I wanted to say beyond that. One is that there is a good cop, bad cop story in the world. There are clearly issues in which the United States carries the stick, and West Europeans come with the carrot, and so the two can only be understood as operating jointly. And of course, this is kind of the beginning of an analysis of global geopolitics as we look at it, considering that both of them are at around 20-22% of the world economy. So the two of them together, even though the EU and the US jointly constitute roughly about 10% of the world's population, or 11 maybe, they do command over 40, probably 45% of the GDP of the world. Okay, so that is what is that, what's the what the story is, and so there is an armed wing, and then there is a there's an ideological slash how should I say softer sort of velvety side to it. And the other thing that needs to be said is that in the meantime we also are talking about another kind of difference in which the EU actually comes out much less attractive than the US. And I will say that with respect to the concept of race. European immigration policy is as it is executed, particularly in the Mediterranean, with respect to the migrants who are attempting to approach the EU by sea, and in the eastern borderlands of the EU, that being Hungary included, carry an explicit racial bias. Studies show that I know somebody who has done interviews, for instance, with consuls who issue visas, Hungarian visas, to non-EU citizens outside the EU territory, of course. And some of them will explicitly tell you that they choose it on the basis of looks and smell. In other words, explicit 19th century racial imageries. And if you ask, ask anybody who is trying to run an international university program, for instance, how difficult it is to get students from the quote-unquote third world, even if they had paid their tuition, the proportion is up to half of the applicants for visas are denied with no explanation. There are students who had been accepted to universities in Hungary, paid the tuition and apply for a visa, and then they're told no. No justification, thank you very much, go away. Now, there's no other way to describe this than an explicit, old-fashioned, racist sensibility. And there's another level, of course, once migrants are here, that is, people from the outside, this West European sphere, it's very clear that their social integration runs into incredibly difficult problems. Millions of Turkish citizens in Germany, millions of citizens of North Africa in France, and so on, who live basically an entire, not one, but several generations' livelihoods in almost complete social isolation. And at some point we will have to start to talk about what the cause of that is. Now, if you look at that and contrast that to the United States, that is, in a very interesting way, the U.S. comes out in a relatively less violent way. You know, there is no explicit racial bias. They do accept a huge number of non-white immigrants in the United States. The demographic growth in the United States is in the non-white category, and it's not just because of differential birth rates, but also because of the incredible numbers of non-European immigrants who are able to attain citizenship status in the United States without regard to their quote-unquote race. So in that sense, the EU, and that is part of the EU's foreign policy in a particular way, right? And so this is that's all I wanted to sort of add.
Stay on this for a moment. I mean, it's, yeah, there is that, but there's the population of Europe and of Hungary is in decline too, right? And so how can, at a time of need for immigrants, how could there be so much racism?
Look, I mean, in Europe we have a number of huge elephants. This is a very small room we live in, and enormous elephants in the room, okay? This is one of the elephants. This is the problem that this whole half continent is rapidly running into. There will be nobody to actually perform work, particularly physical labor, very soon. And it's not just in certain parts, but almost everywhere, including very Catholic countries like Italy, which has a precipitously, catastrophically low birth rate and has had for generations now. And so on the one hand, there is this incredible need for how shall I say, population import. On the other hand, there is an almost complete implicit understanding that non-Europeans are not welcome. And there will be no other sources for populations than non-Europeans. So this is a beautiful story in the sense that these two, one is an objective problem, the other is an implicit sensibility and somewhat anti, let's just say, xenophobic or anti non-European kind of sensibility. The two are grinding down these economies and the societies are. I mean, you know, it's enough to go to even places where relative peace exists. For instance, Berlin, if you go there, you know, it's very clear, you know, the Turkish location there is fairly well established. It's, you know, but even there, the isolation of the Turkish communities is almost complete. You know, housing segregation, their exclusion from the university system, their exclusion from the prestigious jobs, and so on, is very pervasive. As we speak, there is a conversation in Germany about the degree to which the National Socialist, that is explicit Nazi underground groups, have managed to infiltrate the Constitutional Defense Force. That is the equivalent of the FBI in Germany. That is the hearings are going on right now. It's incredible the degree to which blatant racist conversation takes place on the highest levels of the executive apparatus of the German state. Now, with the multi-millions of Turkish citizens having contributed by now almost two complete lifetimes, two generations lifetime to the rise of the German economy, and the fact that there are hardly any Turks in Germany who don't speak as good German as the Germans, and so it's. There's no other sort of objective argument here. So this is what we in Europe should be talking about, and a reasonable forward-looking policy conversation would be about techniques and specific organizational ways or movement style organizing techniques to overcome these problems. And instead of that, there's this technocratic discussion about budgets, which I find extremely depressing, actually.
Vincent.
So,
over to you, Vincent.
From where to start? Yeah. I would start with two figures. The first one is that 20% of the people in the world are appropriating 87% of the resources. 20%, 87%. And we are among, in the West, we are among these people.
Including this country.
Right? Yeah.
And including
the poor people in France. And we have a way of life which is not sustainable, because we have a footprint around three planets, four planets, United States, seven planets, etc. And this model of society based on always growing consumption and always and totally depending on mostly on oil and huge consumption of energies and resources, etc., is neither sustainable nor extendable to other countries. And the problem is that there is a huge political victory, huge cultural victory with that model of society, with so-called capitalism, productivism, consumerism, and the system is very great in communication, in making the people dream, in making that's like advertisement, you know. It plays a lot with very idiotic but effective manipulation to make the people follow this way. And now we are facing this problem here in the West. The people who are totally depending on oil, and we have a very, very, very sophisticated and complex social organization. Just an example, a city like Paris, 10 million people, they are every day airplanes, trucks, boats, trains going to only one hub to feed these 10 million people, and there is no production of food at all, and we have only 4 days of food if we stop importing oil, for example, to France. After 4 days, you have 10 million people without any food production, nothing. It's just an example to see how this system is depending on this very complex system, and which needs always a lot of energy. And the problem is that you mentioned China. You countries like China, India, started to follow the same type of development. And it's a political decision again, and that's one, what you spoke about just before as well. That's one of the worst with what's happened with the political victory of neoliberalism, which is an ideology that it was, it won in a way that it's not a choice, there is no alternative. It's like the law of nature. We managed to make the people believe in that, where behind you have a political decision, a political choice. We want to develop the society in that way with this type of political decision, economic system, etc. And now we are, everybody's following the same way. We are totally depending on this system. The power has never been so much concentrated in the hand of a minority in the world, in Europe, in our societies. Inequalities have never been so huge, north-south inequalities, what I mentioned first, but also in our Western societies where inequalities reach a crazy level. For example, in a country like France, there is a ratio from 1 to 4,000 between the lower salaries to the bigger salaries. That even in middle age, we didn't have so huge inequalities. And in the same time, we already started the wars to appropriate the last barrel of oil, to appropriate the lands. When we speak about immigration, we have to understand why people prefer to die in the Mediterranean Sea than to stay in their country. They don't do it for pleasure. They do it because they are pushed to do it. With that land grabbing, big countries like China, like Western societies like Saudi Arabia, for example, go to poor countries and buy the land and expropriate the people living in that land, where they can produce their own food, live with their tradition, stuff like that. And there is this type of economic imperialism, this type of cultural imperialism that we broadcast everywhere in the world, our model of society, which should make people very happy. We can see it here in Hungary, when what the people expected in the late 80s, when they were fighting against communism and dreaming about having a capitalistic system. The dream, they saw that everybody lived like in Beverly Hills, that everybody's very happy and everything. And we are more than 20 years after, and more people say that, yeah, under Kadar at least, we had a job, we had a security, we could go to a holiday. So this system is very good to sell a dream, to sell an illusion of happiness. And we have to find ways to get rid of that culturally and institutionally. And I think Europe should be the place where it should start. And it should be done in cooperation with other countries. For example, in the degrowth movement, we are very interested in what's happening in South America with that movement called Buen Vivir, the good life, like which was written, for example, in the new constitution of Ecuador. And there are movements in South America where they say that we don't want to use all the resources we have in our countries. We don't want to develop, we just want to have a good life. And in Europe you can see that more and more people start to change their lives. There are more and more movements, more and more local initiatives of people who start to say, no, I don't want to consume anymore, I want to live in a different way. I don't want to buy stupid bad quality products in the Tesco. I want to produce my own food. I don't want to go again, I don't want to buy a car and have to walk to buy a car and to go to work by car. I start to take a bike. And step by step, you can see that more and more people change their way of life, what we call voluntary simplicity in an individual way. There are more and more concrete alternatives with people developing locally alternative economic system, like a local currency, like a transition movement, like a community garden, for example. And in the South, the critics of development is also emerging, but all this mega machine, all this capitalistic system, and the power concentrated in the end of the oligarchy, and the fact that the oligarchy, and it's what we can see in all the Western countries, is preparing themselves to control the people, to make wars. Half of the military budget in the world is a US budget. The first budget in the world is the military budget with $1.600 billion per year. The second budget is advertisement with $600 or $700 billion, where we should put money in local agriculture, in transition to a new type of economic system.
So, just really briefly, Vincent, the European Union apparatus as it is, networked entity, not really a state, is that a potential tool to get to the society you're talking about, or is it just not work for even for that?
I think there in Europe there is great potential, cultural, intellectual, academic, human, to achieve a very great transition to new types of economic system, which could be local, sustainable, desirable, with a bigger participation to the people, a bigger democratic control. And it has already started. This transition is already going on in a very low scale. And in the same time, the oligarchy keeps trying to control more and more. What's happened in last autumn, for example, with the new stability pact about in Europe, when they decided that if a country doesn't respect with 3% public debt, public deficit every year, this country should be controlled by a group of technocrats, of experts from Brussels or from Frankfurt. It's something totally crazy. Where in the same time you can see movements like Occupy movement, like Indignados movement, like all these concrete alternatives, or like this Fast Start movement in Italy with Beppe Grillo, where people want to have another type to make politics, want to have a bigger control on the decision, want to have more transparency, want to produce the things locally in a sustainable way. We are facing the limit to growth. We've just passed the peak oil in 2006, and still we keep going to the same way to look for development. There is, for example, in France, the prime minister with the mayor of a big city in Western France called Nantes, where they want to construct a huge airport. And there is a huge fight in France that people don't want to construct this airport. Because it's from the past. We don't need airports anymore. What we need is to produce food locally. What we need is solidarity. And so there are people occupying this place. And the only answer the government is able to give is to send the police. To send 2,000 policemen fighting with young people trying to make local gardening, trying to construct houses in a sustainable way with wood and stuff like that. And we are a bit facing these things where, on one hand, the oligarchy is totally stuck in a wrong view of the world, with development and everything, and is protecting its own interest. And at the same time, more and more people realize that growth for growth is not a system to follow. It's neither sustainable nor desirable. It doesn't make you happier. And where the people start to reorganize, start to look for more participation and more democracy. And we don't know what will happen, but I think nowadays in Europe, in China as well, in the United States, everywhere at any time, we could have very, very surprising movement emerging. We are really, really, really in an unstable situation, and nobody knows what will happen tomorrow, in a month, in a year, and everything can go to every direction at any time.
Okay, now we're going to do a quick music break, and we'll get back to József Böröcz.
Okay, so we're back again, and Zoltan, Lakatos.
You want me to
fortificate? Yes, what is your response?
No. Just a side note to the issue of the European Union's handling of immigration issues, and it's especially interesting to see how it is reflected on the level of media, at the media level, and I'm going to give you the example of the Hungarian press. There's a kind of long tradition in the Hungarian far-right press to talk about the
One person is missing.
And at this point, Hungary's most well-known left philosopher, TGM, Gáspár Miklós Tamás, walks into the cafe and gives us an announcement that the students have taken over Shirai Cafe in the 6th district.
Ah, oh my God! Welcome.
I just came from the Shirai.
The students have occupied it now.
Yeah.
Through the basement.
Breaking news.
Breaking the lock. Actually.
Breaking the lock.
and now the police has announced their arrival.
Okay.
Yes.
And breaking it up? Or?
I don't know. They were supposed, and the goons were supposed to defend it and to prevent the students from occupying it, but they didn't know that there was a back entrance. It's the usual strategic failure. That's how the British committed it in Singapore. You know. So, right. Actually, I must say that. These kids are just wonderful. So, really, really.
So, we're discussing the European Union and...
Where you now?
And we're talking about the legitimacy of it, right, in terms of democratic governance. Is it legitimate? But also in terms of civilizational growth, is it maintainable and still have something democratic?
It and seems to me that I have so many things to do.
Oh, come on. Just one time.
Okay. No, I couldn't summarize my very complex views of the topic. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, just
one up by everyone.
No, I left off. I mean, just adding a side note to what József said about the issue of immigration and its handling at the European level. So it's interesting to see how it is reflected at the level of national media. So taking the case of Hungary, there's a tradition in the Hungarian far-right press of denigrating people coming from Israel to live in Hungary. And they are said to be numerous. They are said to be arriving in large numbers and taking over the Hungarian economy, especially in real estate and so on and so on. Which is totally untrue. I mean, there may be some people arriving from Israel doing business in the country or settling it, but not a big crowd. And every time this issue is raised in the far-right press, there is some outcry at the left side of the spectrum and pointing out the idiocy of the arguments and so on and so on. Now, for the last couple of years, the so-called left liberal Hungarian media started raising the issue of started the discussion about immigrants from outside Europe coming to Hungary, partly in order to compensate for the declining birth rate. And it's interesting to see that the way it is talked about in the same way as the far-right press is addressing this so-called quote-unquote Jewish issue. Because there's a special focus on Muslims. And in the Hungarian so-called left-liberal media, you have a disgusting and ridiculous rants about Muslims, their backward culture, how these people are going to fuck up the Hungarian education system by not allowing girls to, I mean, going to school, etc., etc. So this is the same kind of racism. I would even go as far as saying that it is not it is not more sophisticated than the usual far-right stuff, but the difference is that in this case, there is no outcry at all.
Yeah.
This is even thought of as kind of, these arguments are thought of as kind of respectable. And maybe we don't quite agree with them, but I mean, they have their place at the
table. It's a mirror image anti-Semitism, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a kind of mirror image anti-Semitism. Yeah. So there's one kind of immigrants who are okay, and another type, maybe the bigger sector or the bigger cluster, who are not welcome. Okay,
and it's something to this. Two things. Well, I mean, I fully agree. Actually, I mean, I think I must have lost at least 30, if not more, friends on Facebook because of this.
On Facebook as well.
Because after a certain point, I cannot take this. So I basically block people because I can't read what they put out. That's the only thing I can do. I mean, other than raising my objections, which I do, and then I'm ridiculed, and then I block. That's how usually it works. But what I want to say is that this is not a unique phenomenon to Hungary. That is the liberal position, the political liberal, that is the middle. It's not the left. There's no left, I mean, almost at all in the Hungarian public conversation. Yeah. I mean, so it's the sort of left liberal, that's about as far as I'm willing to go. Okay? These positions should incorporate a certain implicitly racist, cultural racist argument. Is actually, you can observe that in Western Europe also. My suspicion actually is, because I have been around a while, my suspicion is that this was actually learned behavior. There's actually part of this old story of, you know, these sort of satellites of Western Europe, the local elites, they think their job is to learn and catch up, and they're constantly running, and they're just basically having a little problem determining where to learn, what to learn from, right? And I think that's part of the thing. And the other thing is that there's an unbelievable, I think it's part of a much bigger problem, but this will take us in a different direction. Perhaps the Hungarian society per se may not be such an interesting issue for this particular topic that we're talking about today, but I would like to say that there is an incredible misperception in Hungary regarding their position in the world. The Hungarian society is completely confused about who they are, what they are, in both directions actually. That is, they both severely under and grossly overestimate themselves. I hate to say that, but really quite a few unreconstructed 19th century ideas are still extremely prevalent in the minds of people as points of reference. For instance, the idea of the secluded national space and all these, passé ideas. But coming back, I also wanted to say something which connect to what Vincent said. I want to about the business of the potential of Europe to be a place of experimentation and creativity with regard to sort of new life, buen vivir, if it's buen or not, but let's hope it is. I want to put a little bit of a footnote to that. And as I'm thinking why this is occurring to me, I'm remembering that a few years ago I was in Mumbai at the World Social Forum. I don't know if any one of you guys managed to get there, but it was a really, really crazy setup, in the sense that imagine a huge industrial plant which was abandoned 20 years earlier on the outskirts of Mumbai, with 250 to 300,000 activists. And among them, maybe, if I'm generous, maybe 5 to 10,000 Europeans. In other words, the vast majority of the crowd were barefoot peasants from, Bihar or inner parts of India or other parts of the not so rich part of the world, mainly from Asia. And there are two things that I remember there. One is that there was an incredible climate of creativity and forward-lookingness or progress in terms of the soul of the meeting. And the other, I will say also, is that Europeans were not doing that well in that congress. What I noticed, for instance, very nice guys from Europe, alternative types, but there was not much that they could, in terms of habitus, they didn't find it easy to relate to these barefoot peasants from somewhere, even though the barefoot peasants might have English, you know. What I'm trying to say is that be prepared to be surprised. Just like the buen vivir is not coming from Europe, there might be other things that we might find that are coming from elsewhere. So while we, on the one hand, we should be working on Europe since we are here and we are from here, right? And this is something that we have access to, and I fully think that we should transform European society, but we should do that in such a way that we have to be incredibly open and attentive to what's going on in the rest of the world, and embrace it as much as we possibly can, and learn how to embrace it, because there are many things that we don't know. For instance, just one stupid little example, there was a huge Mela, as they call them, this huge mass meeting. You know, they put down these enormous canvas covers on a large grass area, and there was a stage, some music, and some speeches, and so on. And the people were sitting on that canvas, and the way people were doing it, everybody, except the Europeans, was as they entered from the grass to the canvas, they took off their shoes. Which is, at least in the Indian context, means a certain form of respect. You do that before you enter a temple, you do that before you enter somebody's house. They took off the shoes. I mean, it was not clean, okay, that's not the point, that's not that, you know, that stupid canvas. But Europeans, with the tennis shoes, and everybody was looking, and they're not understanding, and you understand what I'm trying to. So there's another task that we as Europeans have to engage in, and that is to learn, to find out what others do and how they do it, so that we are better, and also not create completely unnecessary false impressions. These kids were very well intentioned, and right. So you understand what I'm. Okay. Yes. That's just my.
Another thing jump to add on Vincent that's resting because of the debt crisis. So amidst all these austerity measures and debt crisis in various countries like Spain, Cyprus, Greece, Ireland, Hungary. Has any one of you seen the European Union, the European Commission's addressing the problem of offshoring, of tax havens? No, never. This is never raised. Why is that? Well, I mean, for example, just one concrete example. Greece, I think that we already addressed this issue in one previous, one of the previous shows, but it's worth addressing it again, because Greece has the single biggest commercial fleet in the entire world, which represents close to 20% of non-military naval traffic. Means, shipment of people and objects, commodities, sorry. And close to 100% of the Greek commercial fleet is registered in Cyprus, you know, in tax havens, offshore, not paying any taxes in Greece. If they were registered in Greece, the Greek people wouldn't have this debt crisis. They wouldn't have to be facing these very brutal austerity measures. Is there any serious talk about this issue at the European level? Barroso talking about the necessity to shut down tax havens? Nothing.
The problem is that of scales. Because, I mean, it is also a problem that, you know, I'm sure all these guys have family who have offshore business themselves. You know, I mean, these elites are like that always. But there is also another problem, which is that you can't fix this on the level of a regional economy.
Yeah.
This is a global issue. This is one of the, you're pointing at one of the fault lines in the architecture of the world economy as we see it. It's coming to the point where there is nothing but fault lines, but this is one of those that you know, there is no global governance, there is no global enforcement, right? There's no rational distribution of the wealth, of collective wealth of humankind, and there is no prevention of this kind of abuses of the system. You know, of course, it is the example you give is a net loss for Greece, but Greece has no, as a state, has no tools whatsoever to enforce that. Not to mention, of course, the fact that you know the people who benefit from it are the most powerful people in Greece anyway, right? So, but you understand, even if the EU shut down the EU offshore arrangements, that means these people. It takes exactly 3 seconds to transfer your money to the Caymans or one of the other 30 or 40 such offshore locations worldwide.
So I would like to be a bit provocative with what you just said. And they can transfer the money because you don't feed the people with money. You feed people with food. You feed people with the land. And it's always the argument given by all, even the most progressive government, like what we... It's not the best progressive one, but we have a left-wing government in France. The socialists, they have the total power. They have everything. President, Senate, Parliament, big region, all the regions except one or two, and all the big towns, etc. They can do whatever they want. But they say that if we tax too much, investors will go away. And I would say, let them go away.
Yeah, do this is a neoliberal argument from the left.
Let them go away. Let them invest somewhere else. We're going to do something else in France. We're going to produce in another way. Okay. And we don't need Areva. We don't need Areva to finance a big army to go to fight in Mali to defend what we call our energetical independence. You know, we should stop these lies. And they are afraid of Areva leaving France, investing somewhere else. Let them go to invest somewhere else and let them finance another country to buy weapons to make a war somewhere else. We don't need that. And after to go back to immigration, we will get people from Mali because we will destroy everything in Mali and they will come to France and we will have to put more policemen to block them. I mean, we should stop with all that crazy processes. And that's why in the degrowth movement, we are really fighting for a basic income or something similar and also a maximum income. We should go back to a maximum income. And maximum income because of justice, social justice, but also to kill this imagination to get rich, to live like a very rich person. It's an objective to follow. It's something which makes happy and something which is normal. No, it's not normal. It's not normal that one person consumes so much oil, that one person concentrates so much power, so much money and everything. And we should be clear. And if this investor want to leave, let him leave. He will get back all the things he will let, the land, and we will do something else on the land he will let. But let him leave, go to a... Moreover, all the big corporation, all the richest people, they already have bank accounts in fiscal paradises. There are already these clearing banks, like Clearstream, for example, where you can, from these societies from Europe, you can, in a very discreet way, without paying any taxes, you can transfer money to this type of paradise. So let them leave.
How can you do this with within the European Union, right? I mean, you're talking, I know you're not saying this, but close down the borders, stop capital from moving, stop the brain drain, if that's happening in France. I know that's happening in Hungary. I mean, how do you do all that within back to the European Union context?
Is there a contradiction there?
Could you repeat please?
The question was, I mean, it sounds, you take out the word France and socialism, it sounded very nationalistic to me from a Hungarian perspective. You're saying, like, everything should be local, right? Now, how do you keep that and keep these European things? I mean, borders used to be good because it kept people and capital from moving out. So, is that the solution?
You can see coming back everywhere in every country discussions about protectionism and how to protect our economies from investors, from whatever. And I don't really like this term protectionism because I think we don't have to protect. I don't have to protect myself from the Chinese. They are just people like me and I'm not afraid of them. But we should relocalize our economic system. Not because I am in competition with somebody else, but because it makes sense. It's more sustainable. You know, we should stop with that craziness to produce tomatoes in South Spain and sell them in Netherlands and produce tomatoes in Netherlands and sell them in other supermarkets in Spain. All this craziness we should stop. So it's more sustainable to produce locally what you can produce locally. And it has human sense. It's another interaction between the people. It's what we can see with all that experiences around the direct trade. When you start to create alternative economic system with a direct connection between the producer and the consumers. And when you have such a system, everything is based not on money, not on law, but it's based on trust. It's based on direct human relationship. It's based on solidarity and trust. And you don't have a democracy without trust. And we do it. I mean, we should relocalize because it makes sense, because it makes you happier, because it changes the human interaction, what you can have locally, etc. But it doesn't mean that we have to close the borders for that. I think we should have what we call an open relocalization. We relocalize what we can relocalize, we relocalize which makes sense to be relocalized, but we should let the people free to move. Now we have a world where nobody is free to move, except for a minority like us in the Schengen zone. If you have a French passport, you can travel almost everywhere without any problem. But most of the people, they don't have this chance. But all the goods can travel for free without any problem. We can import without any problem resources from Africa, but African people cannot travel to Europe without visa, without very difficult procedures to apply for and stuff like that. So it's really the question to rethink locally and globally. What do we produce? How do we produce it? For what kind of use? And in how do we produce it? It's really how to share the task, how to do it in another way, how to do it in a sustainable way.
So this is Hungary, right? And we've had this conversation before where people have adopted this neoliberal ideology. This is the new trend. 30 years ago, the elite have, yes, the elite, you're right, the people are quite cynical, of course, but this is the new religion. So here's the latest new idea coming from France. I mean, is it possible that this could be adopted just as easily or just as impossibly in the future? I mean,
speaking of Hungary?
Yeah, I mean, he's talking about degrowth. I'm thinking, like, is this possible in Hungary? I mean, these ideas would... Yeah, well, Hungary is very good at degrowth.
That's already very good.
A model, maybe. Yeah, sorry. I cannot give you a nuanced reply on the chances of degrowth in Hungary.
Of course. But how ideology is accepted by the
ideology?
And the universities?
No, I mean, yeah. Let me give you...
how do we change our mindset to make this work?
Hungary is perhaps the only country which is the most backward, speaking of its intellectual culture. Every fashion finally reaches Hungary, but very late, you know. So I mean, neoliberalism still has a long future in Hungary. So it will be a very long time before any of these subjects will be addressed in a serious discussion. It's always down to the stupid rivalry between the two main factions of the political elite. If you raise these subjects in Hungary, especially in the press, the only prison through which it is seen, it whether it serves the interest of the ruling Orbán coalition or the main forces of the opposition. So you cannot have a serious discussion. So the chances of this being addressed in a serious manner are very slim.
So it would be responsive to crises, not positive ideology.
I would say that those Hungarians interested in these issues should discuss these things at the global level, at the European level at least, and probably not in Hungarian. Even with the participation of Hungarians, probably not. It's not a good idea to address these issues in Hungarian, because even our daily language, Hungarian language is corrupted. You cannot think. There's a lot of issues you cannot think of seriously in Hungarian without raising the suspicion of the elites.
I would like to say something about Hungary, because I wouldn't be so much I wouldn't be so much pessimistic, which is I know that it's a bit like a tradition in Hungary to be very pessimistic.
It shows you're not Hungarian.
And I've been living in this country between Paris and Budapest for 10 years, and I think here in this country, which is the country where Karl Polanyi, one of the greatest
sociologists
or economists or historians.
In my notes, right?
yeah. Was born. He grew up here in Hungary, and he's one of the fathers of the degrowth thinking. And here, there, like everywhere in Europe, in different, different ways, there are a lot of very interesting things happening. And if you think about what's happened around Andjan József, the former rural development state secretary, and who's now an MP because he resigned, and the strategy for rural development he wrote for the next 15 years, it's a very visionary and progressive in sense of degrowth, emancipatory and interesting strategy to make agricultural and energetical and the human economical transition to new type of economic system, which could be sustainable, and Hungary could have become or could still become a very interesting positive laboratory of a successful transition to a new model of society. And where I agree with you, and I think it's not, unfortunately, it's not only in Hungary, but we have all these elites here in Hungary, so-called progressive liberal elites. But you have the same in France, who studied in the big elite schools, and they are totally conditioned to only think in one way, neoliberalism. And they are really the watchdogs of the system, really. If you see all these French journalists coming from Sciences Po, which is an elite school in Paris, dealing with political sciences, all these journalists, the way they behave, as soon as there is somebody like me, for example, speaking about new ways, speaking about new ideas and stuff like that, their goal is really to put back the sheep to the right direction. And it's the same here, it's the same in France, I guess it's the same everywhere in the world. So, but also among them, a bit everywhere, you can see people, you know, I make a PhD about degrowth here in Hungary. There are more and more people dealing with degrowth in universities. There are more and more people dealing with degrowth among the elite. And there are more and more and more people, without speaking about degrowth, without making a big theoretical work, who start to change their way of life, to reappropriate some freedom. Because when you start to go to a voluntary simplicity, you get some freedom. If you don't need anymore to consume so much, you don't have to work so much, you don't have to make stupid jobs, you don't have to make some so big debts, etc., etc. So I wouldn't be so much negative. And in Hungary, there are a lot of very interesting initiatives as well. And I have a project to develop, and we have a collective of young researchers and also a collective of young people from the civil society. We have a project to develop a big degrowth experimentation and a research center here in Budapest. So there are a lot of interesting things here happening.
I have two sets of things to say, and they somehow contradict each other, at least on some level. So, but I actually don't mind that too much. One is very much connecting to what Zoltan said. The problem in this country, Hungary, is that, look, there are very severe problems in the ideational sphere in this society. I think that's very clear to everybody, including many Hungarians, by the way, in some way. I'll just pick up one thread that seems relevant to me. In addition to what I already mentioned, which is that Hungarians have a very, very confused idea about where they are and who they are in the world, there's another thing, which is that this is a society which is a definitely very clearly post-state socialist society. You know, a lot of the political conversation derives from that implicit assumption. It makes references to that and so on. And yet, it is a society in which a proper historical elaboration, public conversation about what state socialism was and what it meant globally, what it meant within the Soviet bloc, what it meant for Hungary, is completely absent. The way I describe it in my writing is that, on the one hand, there were very powerful, intellectually quite engaging critiques of state socialism during the last two decades, but the transformation that actually happened had almost absolutely nothing to do with those indigenous critiques of state socialism. In other words, the transformation took place under the aegis of an imported set of ideas that is what we refer to as a shorthand as the neoliberal consensus. Now, this was not because I mean, it had something to do with the, let's just say, openness of Hungarian elites to borrowing stuff in, particularly from the West, in these narrow ways, and always twisting them to their own personal benefit and so on, making shortcuts and so on. But it's, in all fairness, this, the part of the reason is also that that was at a time, the end of the 1980s, was a time when the global ideological hegemony of neoliberalism was at its absolute height. And so it was in some ways, so this transformation, the collapse of state socialism itself is actually partly a product of that. Because why is it that the particular political powers that managed the transformation saw no socialist alternative? Well, because they also already had an understanding that socialism is by definition impossible. No form of socialism is possible, right? Remember Tomás Sarkozy, Hungarian Minister of Justice, in the 1989, when he submits the company transformation law in parliament and starts his speech by saying the worst capitalism is better than the best socialism. That's only possible in a context in which a proper historical discussion of what state socialism was is already understood to be impossible. It's going to be banned, and we are operating under that ban. We banned ourselves, right? I mean, this is a collective property that emerges in the Hungarian context. Now, the problem is that socialism as an idea is too strong and too powerful to be fully repressed. It means a lot of things, not just state socialism, but many, many, many things. And more importantly, it is one that really occupies, in terms of political spectrum, the imagination for the future of a large part of that spectrum, the left. So if socialism is banned, forbidden, then that means the left is banned. And because of that, there is basically no left articulation of politics in Hungary, except for a handful of people who are routinely called in, either completely ignored or called into national media only to be ridiculed. Right? Now, but what does that do in more general terms? Well, what happens is that a critique of on the other hand, the society is toiling under the effects of the neoliberal policies. Therefore, there has to be something. So what happens, first of all, is an emotional response. It's not possible to talk about it in normal creative ways. So we will just basically curse. Which is what happens, right? The second thing is that there is another critique of neoliberalism, and that comes from the extreme right, which, in my opinion, explains not just the spectacular emergence of the extreme right in Hungary, which scares me to death, but it has happened, but also partly the very significant success of the current ruling coalition, which also attacked neoliberalism on the level of slogans from the right. And then the third thing is that any critique of neoliberalism, even if it's the most sophisticated kind and the most gentle kind, will be interpreted in local social network terms. In other words, X, Y, or Z is critiquing this because he's not friends with those guys and he's not that camp. He's another camp. And so there's never enough camps. Hungarians love this camp business. So this is one thing. We're in 2013. That's 24 years after the collapse of state socialism. Okay. I mean, it's unbelievable. This is like as far from the collapse of state socialism as 1969 was from the end of World War II. And we are still completely caught in this taboo. And because of that, a critique of neoliberalism is not going to, a normal conversation will not be possible until we somehow deal with what it means to be on the left, what is a reasonable left position, what are the alternatives, and so on. And now, the other thing that I will say, which is a partial contradiction, but only apparently, I think, is that meanwhile, neoliberalism is actually dead. It's dead. As an ideology, it's completely discredited. It's the irony of history, you know. I mean, the crisis that struck the U.S. and the West European economies, which is a combination of lack of growth and the incredible imminent need for state subsidies to the otherwise supposedly fully autonomous, self-regulated sector of the banking industry, right? I mean, showed, and there was explicit conversation, and there is an explicit search for an alternative conceptualization of global capitalism going on right now in the U.S. government, as well as on the level of the intergovernmental organizations, the World Bank, IMF, and so on. Not to mention the EU. They haven't found anything yet. They will not find it because they're working with enormous intellectual limits. But the point is that this thing is gone. Everybody knows that. Who is looking at it with a relatively, let's just say, unbiased view. But it will take another generation before this realization will seep through to the power holders, the intellectual elite power holders in Eastern Europe. So that's I think, the correct description of the situation. So in some ways, what we are talking about here, the terms under which we talk today, might sound strikingly radical for many of the listeners of the show, but at the same time, they're not that exciting. I mean, in some other level. I mean, these are fairly commonplace things. You know, I mean, most of my references in my work and my lectures to facts. I'm asking the audience to please consider the facts on the ground, and that will. So that's the sort of the strangeness of the Hungarian ideological landscape, I suppose.
So what's the future of Hungary?
Future of Hungary?
Yeah. You can't say all that and not say that. So.
Over to you, Vincent.
it will depend on the football game tonight against Romania. No, I think Hungary, like most of the countries in Europe, is facing with, of course, a different and its own particularities, short history, and also cultural and particular context. It's facing the same problems, you know. If you think about Italy, they also have a problem about the left. This movement, which is the new political party in Italy, is neither left nor right. The extreme right-wing, far-right movements started to grow based on things which were historically said by the alter-globalist movement. I think Jobbik...
Also true in Hungary.
Yeah, Jobbik started to become a strong movement, and Jobbik is going up in the polls when they don't say bullshit like John Dioshi with a list of Jews or these type of things. They grow up... When they deal with anti-neoliberalistic system, when they deal with more protection, when they deal with new economic system. They do it in a very stupid way, very simply, in simplifying
and
the
violent,
things, etc.
Violent,
and violent way.
Cult of violence, but, which is, by definition, cuts them off from the left.
Yeah. And I think, you know, it was in this country where this movement, Another Politics is Possible, was created. It was in 2008. It was 2 years, 3 years before the Indignados movement or Occupy movement, where we could find the same type of thinking, same type of discussion. And it doesn't touch, of course, a big majority of the people and only a minority. And when you see what's happened with that party which exploded a few weeks ago, if you see what's happened in other countries with this type of initiatives, like this Five Stars movement, there are a lot of interesting things. Everywhere in the world, there are more and more people who understand that this party system, this representative democracy, these old ideologies, they don't work anymore. And people are looking and try to find new ways to make politics, to reappropriate politics, to take decisions together, to do the things in another way. And unfortunately, neither in Hungary nor anywhere else, we found solutions. We are just a bit everywhere trying to experiment new things.
Okay, thank you, József Böröcz and Vincent Liegey and Zoltan Lakatos, as well as TGM, Gáspár Miklós Tamás, for all participating in the show, participating in the interview part of the show at the Espresso Embassy, which is at Aran János utca in the 5th District. In my opinion, the most delicious coffee in Budapest. And let's listen to a little bit of music, and when we come back, we're going to listen to this clip from Paul Murphy, the MEP from in the European Union representing the Republic of Ireland. Okay, next, as I said, Paul Murphy, who's an MEP, representative in the European Parliament for the Republic of Ireland. And this was in the Irish Parliament, the Joint Committee on EU Affairs, and the discussion was about Ireland and the future of the EU. And the discussion is really about what are the prospects of democracy in the EU when the IMF and the ECB and these troikas are in total control over the budgets of the national budgets of these countries, as well as of their economies, basically. And I think this is the topic of our era, really. And I think that Paul Murphy really nails it really hard in this short 12-minute speech that he gives in this subcommittee, or the committee, anyways. So let's listen to Paul Murphy, representative of Ireland to the European Union, speaking in the Irish Parliament subcommittee, or Joint Committee on EU Affairs.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for the invite, and thanks for printing out the slides. I overestimated the eyesight of the esteemed members of the committee. I'm going to focus with my short time that I have.
I wouldn't overemphasize that one. We can read and see as well.
You won't make the same mistake.
Don't worry.
I'm going to focus my remarks on, I mean, we were asked three questions. I'm going to focus on the first two, just because of time, on the question of financial, budgetary and economic policy integration in the EU, and democratic accountability and legitimacy and political union. My contention is that there is a very profound change happening in the European Union at the moment. It's a change that is happening without enough discussion, without enough debate, without enough awareness about what's happening. And it is, as President Barroso said, it's a silent revolution. On the first slide there, a silent revolution in terms of stronger economic governance by small steps. The member states have accepted, and I hope they understood it exactly, but they have accepted very important powers of the European institutions regarding surveillance and a much stricter control of the public finances. In my opinion, it's a revolution or a counter-revolution that is well underway, that has made significant strides already in the direction that it wants to go, but that there's a lot more and a further direction left to go. In my opinion, the model at which it's driving towards could be summed up with the phrase authoritarian neoliberalism. What do I mean by authoritarian neoliberalism? Effectively, you can sum it up in three aspects. One, the technocratization of economic policymaking, by which I mean economic policy is no longer a matter for political debate between left and right, between neoliberals, Keynesians, socialists, but instead there's a right answer and there's a wrong answer, and the right answer happens to be the answer favoured by the Thatcherites and the neoliberals. So that's like an ideological assault that takes place with the rising of economists to be high priests, etc., who simply can't be questioned. Secondly, flowing on from that, it makes the right policies, neoliberal policies, it makes them law. That's what we've seen so far. I'll go on to explain it. But it embeds neoliberalism in law in the European Union and in member states of the European Union, in national legislation. And at the same time, in the words of Martin Callanan, the leader of the British Conservatives in the European Parliament, it's making socialism illegal. In reality, it's making Keynesianism illegal. It's making, you know, significant state expenditure, running deficits, etc. It's making them illegal under the rules of the European Union and the process of economic governance. And then thirdly, it involves a significant transfer of power. And that's real. I don't think it's disputable. The transfer of power from elected governments to unelected bodies, in particular the European Commission and the European Central Bank. Why is it happening? Is it a response to the crisis, or is it taking advantage of the crisis? In my opinion, it's both. It's partly a response to the crisis within the framework that the political establishments across Europe know, which is a framework of neoliberalism. But it's also an example of what Naomi Klein calls the shock doctrine, whereby you use a shock, in this case clearly created by neoliberal capitalism, to go further in embedding those very policies. And that is what's happening at the moment. I have two quotes on that slide from the two biggest big business lobbying organisations in Europe, the European Roundtable of Industrialists and Business Europe. The EORT, European Roundtable of Industrialists, said, this is in 2002, said, at the drafting stage, the implications of national budgets and of major national fiscal policy measures should be reviewed at the level of the Union. Well, that's what's been agreed over the past 2 years. This is something that has been pushed by big business in Europe over an extended period of time. But given the opportunity of the crisis, they've been able to go ahead and push it and have it successfully implemented. And a quote from Business Europe from spring 2010, that the Eurogroup will have to assume greater responsibility in improving economic governance in the euro area and put greater emphasis on domestic and competitiveness imbalances, which have proved in most recent developments to be a major source of fiscal instability. Again, that's precisely what has been done through the six-pack, through the two-pack, through the fiscal treaty. They're the changes that are being implemented, and they were wished for in advance of the crisis. In terms of what's happened so far, I think you can refer to, on the one hand, non-legislative measures, which is, it's a nice term for what's been happening, and the other hand, legislative measures. So in terms of non-legislative measures, what we've seen, and you know, largely without a peep in terms of the establishment media or so on, we've had the removal of elected governments in Greece and in Italy, their replacement of governments by bankers, for bankers, whose mandate does not come from the peoples of those countries, but rather comes from the markets. We've had European Central Bank ransom notes. sent to, for example, Berlusconi on the 5th of August 2011, seeking a series of measures that had to be implemented, finishing with the ominous line, "We trust that the government will take all the appropriate actions," because Italians needed the ECB to buy the bonds on Monday morning. If they didn't, there'd be a collapse for them. The bond prices would go through the roof, and so the ECB was unelected, unaccountable institution, was holding the sword over the Italian government, which obviously I completely disagree with that Italian government. And we know the same. We don't know the details because we haven't seen the letters, but we know letters were sent to the Irish government at the end of 2010. And obviously the experience of Troika, so-called supervision, whereby the Troika dictates, yes, there's a certain discussion, but primarily dictates economic policies to the governments of Greece, governments of Portugal and governments of Ireland. They're the non-legislative measures we've seen so far, but also there's been a series of legislative measures. So three, really. The six-pack, which we only heard about in Ireland in the course of the fiscal treaty debate, but which had already happened at that stage, the fiscal treaty itself, and the two-pack, which will come before the European Parliament next week. I will oppose it, but I think it's overwhelmingly likely to be passed, unfortunately. And what they have done together, they've made the stability and growth pact targets binding. So the 3% deficit, the 60% debt-to-GDP ratio, they've made them binding and subject to fines if countries don't meet those targets or be heading towards meeting those targets. They've imposed rules in national law of binding force and permanent character about a structural deficit, which is new, that wasn't in Stability and Growth Pact, of 0.5%, as well as the Stability and Growth Pact targets. It's introduced a procedure called the Excessive Deficit Procedure, which 20 countries in the EU are currently in, which subjects them to a large degree of supervision by the European Commission in particular. The introduction of a system which hasn't been discussed at all called the scoreboard system, which is new. It's beyond stability and growth. It's 10 other indicators that the Commission now uses to monitor the economies of the EU countries. And if countries exceed their scoreboard targets, they can be put in what's called an excessive imbalance procedure, and again can be subject to fines if they don't implement the correct corrective measures, which are always Thatcherite, which are always neoliberal. They've changed the voting rules in the Council with breathtaking cynicism, whereby the qualified majority voting has been turned on its head, and now when you're voting on sanctions for countries like fines if they haven't implemented sufficiently rigorous austerity in the view of the Commission, it's almost impossible to stop those fines being passed, because it's presumed to pass unless you can get a qualified majority against it. And also countries who are subject to fines, miscreant countries, lose their vote. They lose their vote on other subsequent votes that will take place about fining other countries. An attack on democracy at the level of the European Council and the introduction of the European semester. In terms of the two-pack, just to give an example of some of the details, because we just hear, oh, OK, the budget's going to take place in October now. That's all the difference it's going to make, as if there's something completely innocuous about the two-pack. I've a couple of quotes. So a common budgetary timeline is introduced, and it's not just about everyone doing it at the same time. That's there for a purpose. It's for a purpose that the Commission can apply political pressure on governments to make sure that budgets are changed if necessary, to make sure enough austerity, in their view, is implemented. So the Commission now has the power to request a revised draft budgetary plan in accordance with the provision of this regulation. The introduction of economic partnership programmes, which detail in a detailed way the policy measures and structural reforms needed to ensure an effectively durable correction of the excessive deficit. That's an agreement really between the Member State and the European Commission. And enhanced surveillance, which again will put a number of countries, not just countries who are in so-called bailouts, but other countries, put them in the same position, whereby they're extensively subject to surveillance. I think there's a lot more to come, a lot more to come. The paper that Ema referred to, the Towards a Genuine Economic and Monetary Union, everyone should read that if they haven't. There's different drafts of it. It's kind of different iterations as they go through discussions. People should read them all, because even the stuff that's come out of the latest drafts, it doesn't mean it's still not there in terms of the plan that the elites within Europe, Van Rompuy personally, but in particular Barroso, I'd say as well, have a mind to. Just some quotes to give you an indication. So the first quote: the reforms introduced through the creation of the European semester are a step in the right direction, but there is a need to go further. This is the start, not the end of the process for them, and it ends for them in a political fiscal union with an absence of democracy of real democracy, a real control by people over economic affairs, and with austerity institutionalized. A fully fledged integrated budgetary framework would require the establishment of a treasury function with clearly defined fiscal responsibilities. What they're talking about there is a European Minister of Finance, or at least a European Finance Ministry. That is the direction that they want to go with this process. And again, not necessarily subject to democratic check or accountability. I'll leave out the third quote. The fourth quote, which I think this is more where they're currently at, and what we're currently going to see, is a real emphasis on arrangements of a contractual nature between member states and EU institutions. They want to have contracts for austerity between the different member states in Europe and the European Commission. And it's a way of subverting democracy, because the contracts won't bind the government, they'll bind the state. And so if a government is kicked out because people don't like austerity, people vote against austerity, in law at least, the contract will bind the government that then comes in. To finish, what's so bad about all of this? Does this not make sense? Is it not the only way to save the euro? Is it not the only way to save our economies? Firstly, I think it's fundamentally undemocratic. It's a fundamentally undemocratic process. It's taking power away from people to decide on economic policy. It's taking economic policy out of the sphere of political debate. But secondly, I think that institutionalized austerity, which is what this means deeper crisis. It's not going to solve the economic crisis. It is austerity that is being implemented across Europe. It is austerity that has resulted in 0.6% contraction in GDP in the last quarter of last year. Eurozone has gone back into recession. It's obviously caused, you know, disaster for many, many people, 26 million people unemployed, and social devastation in Greece in particular. So you see the consequences for people. But why is this policy then being pursued? I would finish with the idea that austerity is working. It's working for those it's meant to work. Austerity was never envisaged as a plan to save the economy, improve people's lives, etc. It was envisaged as a plan by which the very rich, the 1% in our society, could strengthen their position at the expense of the rest of them. The bondholders have been protected. Profits are up pretty much right across the European Union. Privatisation is being pushed. Wages, generally speaking, have been pushed down. The result is that you have 750 billion euros in excess cash holdings in listed EU companies. So profits are going up, investment by the private sector continues to decline, and the result is large amounts of cash sitting on the balance sheets of big business. In my opinion, the way out of this crisis is through public investment, is through socialist policies. But they are precisely the policies that are attempted to be outlawed through this whole process of authoritarian neoliberalism. Finally, what is to be done? Massive protest across Europe. To be honest, what we need, and I know people here probably won't agree with me, or most of them, we need... the picture there is from the 14th of November in Spain, when you had a general strike in Spain, in Italy, in Greece, in Portugal, in Malta, and in Cyprus. We need a European-wide struggle of working people against austerity and against this process of undemocratic process of authoritarian neoliberalism. Thanks a lot.
This is Radio Cash, tearing up the seven bales. This is Radio Cash, please save us, not the whale. This is Radio Cash, underneath the mushroom cloud. This is Radio Cash, don't need that primrose swell.
Thank you for listening to Mindenki Yoga. You can always find us online at lmv.hu/Mindenki Yoga, and you spell Mindenki Yoga like this, MindenkiJoga. You can always find us on Facebook, just type in Mindenki Yoga and you'll find us. And you can always send us email at mindenkiyoga@mailbox.hu. Thank you for listening, and please share our material on Facebook and Google Plus and everywhere else. It's always good to get new listeners out there. Thank you very much.
My identity, but now this